Tonight, we are inaugurating the Annalisa Soros Visiting Artist Program, and our first guest is Mr. Jonathan Babose, and his journey to English biography. Jonathan is so into the music, which means so much to him. And because we want to end at 6:30, he has recruited me as a friend to be a timekeeper and to remind him, give him reminders when it's time to move on. And now I'm going to trade microphones. We will invite our first pianist, Jimmy, to perform the first movement of the Lisa.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you. too happy with many, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. With a few things we have said, like the beginning of Tira. Funny enough, what I think was less convincing, or could even be better, is the opening. I was demonstrating to you the particularity of this bit. I was rather proud with my demonstration, and I had the feeling you understood. But of course, when we come on stage, you know, we are shaking. So you have to somehow calm yourself and say, what is at stake here? What is the most important? You know that it's one of the few, if not the only one actually, where Beethoven writes words under music. Not to be sung, but for the meaning of the purpose of the piece, which has a title, Les Adieux, Les Verbaux, and Beethoven writes. He writes that in the score. That's the only example we have with words that should not be sung. Mm-hmm. And I thought you played that a little bit too normal. And not enough as a statement which the entire movement, these three notes, that the entire movement will be built on. My demonstration to Jamie was that actually this chord is not the one you expect, the third one, but that's what you expect, and not the C minor chord. Minor chord. On top of it, you write espresso. Mm-hmm. You are a little too strict. Two things. Sol, fa, mi is levable. And on top of it, the vol of levable has more weight because that's not the chord you are expecting. Mm-hmm. I know we have little time, but I would so much love to leave Southampton and hear you playing this beginning
okay. The
way you can. Second remark, I thought my demonstration was very good once again, but you missed a little bit the point. This line is full of silence. And also, I'm sure that has to do a little bit with your very normal nervosity. If we are on stage, we should be a little bit nervous. I mean, we don't come here as if we go to breakfast, right? It's people are watching, hearing, we have Beethoven above us looking at, and so many things. Nevertheless, you were eating the silence. Do you remember what I told you? Fill the silence with musical motifs. Mm-hmm. Let's demonstrate that so that everybody can understand. Mireille, for me. From here. Precise. I know it's not a real masterclass, but you should hold the chords the way Beethoven wrote. Mm-hmm. You are playing too short. You have to sell this expression, not as if you are trying on the piano to see how this chord sounds. Or,
yeah.
You know, they have to, and then the explosion.
Yeah.
Many things were fantastic in the Allegro, bravo, bravissimo. You could take more time for this. Ooh.
Of course.
Sometimes we take for granted some of the incredible novelty of. This is not a chord that it's so bizarre, it sounds so strange. Play it as such. You take your time, because from this chord, the entire section depends, because you do. And you will play for half an hour before you reach the theme here that you did so well. I was so happy you were here. Wonderful. Okay, now, in this entire passage, be careful that this is a percussion instrument.
Yeah.
This decay is terrible. This is the cross we have to live with as a pianist. We cannot hold the sound. Therefore, when you have a long note, a long chord like this one, like this one, like this one, like this one, play it a little more. On top of it, it is motif material, which directly refer to. So we said that the last chord is important. Here also the last chord is important. You are doing. You see what I mean?
Yes.
Instead of. Exactly. This is common tech.
Okay.
Common tech. This is not important. This is important. This note. This chord. Can you play it back? Okay, you understand the difference? Now, another thing, and that's going to be my last comment, that I cannot restrain, I told you already. That in the end of this sonata, you have something so extraordinary that some edition corrected Beethoven. They could not believe that Beethoven is writing such a chord. It's a canon. If I play both hands together, here. Now, if I play them in canon, and the editor, I own the edition, wrote. kitchen. Yes, I said kitchen. There is a piano in the kitchen in the house. And you start the piece, and I ask you, what time is it? And you look at the clock, and you say, wait, it's 4 o'clock. I said, no, no, no. Not the real time, the time of your piece. What time is it for you in the piece? And you said, very early in the morning, which was perfectly correct. Everybody is still sleeping. So why are you making such a jazz feeling tone? Ta, chi, ta, bom, chi, ta. You know, you dance. No, it's early morning. Everybody is very tired. Nobody's awake. Tired. No, 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 no. Slow action. Slow. Everything is slow. Okay, that's a very good example, like the Opus 11, 111. It starts immediately also. Not at all. It's a piece that starts slow. Now, something interesting also. In the Beethoven we worked with Beethoven, the indication was espressivo. Right? I asked Owen to make it more of a statement of the beginning, because it's espressivo right from the first note. Do you remember what Debussy wrote for this? Sans expression. Without expression. Without expression here, when you, after you reach that. Like in Beethoven, in Debussy. I had a revelation one day. I do that quickly, but somehow to tell you what I think is the Debussy world. My wife and I, so she wakes up, it's not 4 o'clock in the morning, it was normal time, and she says, oh, I had a marvelous dream last night, made a wonderful dream. Okay, tell me. Oh, it was marvelous. It was so marvelous. Really, it was marvelous, but she could not remember anything. Just the feeling of a marvelous dream. And it was a revelation to me. I said, that's exactly what Debussy music is about. The piece is finished, you don't remember anything. Because actually there are no material to grab. But there is an impression that comes out. So you have to make the impression very clear. The piece starts as a zero. There is no waves, nobody is awake, okay? And don't try to make that sexy. Now this ritenuto that you have after each phrase is the ritenuto of an energy which is not there, which is dying, you know? Exactly like when you yawn. So I find you too quick. You. This quint is already the sea, and the sea is not 2 meters deep, it's super deep. And from that note, from this quint, if this quint is not played properly, the rest cannot hold. That's it. Everything comes from that. You have exactly the same here. It's under in terms of volume. The second one has an accent, too bad. They can write pedal that you press from here, and then there is a signal where you have to release your feet. Okay, this is very precise. But there is other ways. If the bass has to be held, you can do that on this pedal. Especially at the end when you have one. Can you start here? Try to produce a massive sound. Now, this chord that you need to play. Next time, continue. And the second one. Two of them. This one. And this one. Do you see them? How big they are? One here and one there. And if you smash them, you need to, you cannot just do pop. You as if the Bartok, beginning of Bartok was a kind of, I would do that if there is a thematic material which is linked or tonality. It's a little strange for me. You see what I mean?
Yes.
And how you connect, because you do that within and you never show us that the piece is finished before you start the other. So your body language was telling us that actually you thought like a virtual glissando from the last chord to the first note of the bar.
Yes.
Better you take your hands off and then. Now, Scriabin, it's the first time I hear you do that. With this texture of Scriabin, it's so easy to fall in an area where, it's, by the way, your sound world that you create is super. Don't change that. That's very good. But I would like to know a little bit where I am. I'm a little bit lost. And when I say a little bit, yes, metrically and also on the pure form of it. It's a twice exactly the same. And basically you have two sections, one here and one here. Right?
Yes.
And you don't characterize them enough. They are, the general color is super, but you need to add some elements which are a little bit more defined. Don't dilute, everything is too diluted in your play. For example, something like that is definitely too much diluted. You did it once, let's see, play for them so they know what we are talking about. Well, you change. Now you change. Nobody in the audience could imagine that. There is point on that. We have we never heard the point. Actually, not true. We heard it once. The second time,
okay.
You see, you have to be consequent with that. You have to be consequent. So add a little bit of air. It's a I think basically a pedal problem.
Yes.
Okay. And so that's my first comment. Second comment: be very careful that whatever inner voice you bring out, or you want to bring out, it's not. The price to pay for that is that we don't hear the main voice. Second voice is wonderful, you know, but piano playing is like a McDonald's. Also, I should not say this here. But the more or in a sandwich, the more layers there is, the better the taste of the sandwich there is. So of course a great pianist should be able, especially in the music of art, you know, Scriabin, you know, should add different layers. But you need to have a very clear mind what is the first one and the second and the third. Too many times I had second notes of arpeggio, much too loud. Be careful that the bass I understand, but be careful that the left hand is not killing. Can you start again and bring a little bit more of the... I know you want to create a soft kind of hypnotic sound, yes? But nevertheless, you can. Yeah, you know, the pianissimo is only here. It's only for that. Not even at the beginning. Another thing, not sure I understood anything what's going on here in this speech.
Yes.
very interesting because actually, when we worked, we worked in this small room and here. So this stage in general is like a magnifier. You know, suddenly you see it increase the concept you have of a piece, or the level of concept, your intention or your lack of intention. You know, it creates, it's like a magnifier like that. And in such a piece, but also a little bit like with Robert with his Scriabin, your sound world and your approach is super beautiful. Be very, very, very careful not to fall in the contemplation of the moon, in the kind of how shall I say, just not look how beautiful it is. It's a love story. It's actually a passion. And not looking at the moon and say, I think it was better yesterday, no, don't you think? No. Last month was better, no? But you see what I mean? Like a common, no, it's not that. It's a unique chance to tell your loved one you love him or her, you know what I'm saying? Therefore, I was really surprised that it was not the climax, but you played. The kiss, so to speak, and the ecstasy, and then the rest is okay. So think of it. Another thing: try, if possible, not to make the first beat waiting every time. Something you didn't do. By the way, what is the tempo indication?
Allegro? Andante.
Sorry. So, andante,
allegro
would be really. But it's an andante. It's, so it should move. It's not an adagio, you know, religioso or something. No,
yeah.
It should move. On top of it, it has très expressive. So, add movements. You know, you could. You definitely could. Another thing which I think you could improve. I think during the lesson you understood, but you went back to your which is showing me that da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da for you is what is first, and you forget. So if your ear is connected to the bass, try. The C, much more. Do it. It's a horn. It goes here. So continue the voicing. Okay? incredible beauty, which is at the end
the return of the top.
Okay? So a little bit less, and be careful, this is not a fermata, very interesting. The last chord. Oh, just this, and then we. So you understand, morendo jusqu'à la fin, it means not morendo here, but until the end. So move. Could you just play for us the first time the Dies Irae appears? We need to. Yeah. And you will understand why. Now play the Dies Irae alone. First motif of the theme of Paganini, da-da-da-da, but not. And for the pianist, it's super hard. Is when you have the last variation. Super hard to recognize, but as a pure composition point of view, it's extraordinary. Now, of course, everybody knows this famous 18th variation, which actually is using a theme completely new. We never heard da 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 da. Completely new. Completely new. Where does it come in from? Now, follow me. The mirror of that would be. Okay? That's the mirror. The symmetry. Okay? I play it in major. Here is my theme. Oh, I see some here. You always thought it was a new theme. It's not. It is a double transformation. First of all, mirror, actually triple transformation. Mirror, major instead of minor, and in another key. And that's the result. Rachmaninoff.